got a lovely opening prayer already, and I want to just start with a little scripture to reflect on, too, in addition to that opening prayer that Father Logan led us in. And it's a familiar passage that you've probably heard many times, but from Deuteronomy, from the 30th chapter, the end of the 30th chapter of Deuteronomy, about that choice that is laid before Israel. So I'll just read that passage. Here then I have set today before you life and prosperity, death and doom. If you obey the commandments of the Lord your God, which I enjoin on you today, loving him and walking in his ways and keeping his commandments, statutes and decrees, you will live and grow numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land you are entering to occupy. If, however, you turn away your hearts and will not listen, but are led astray and adore and serve other gods, I tell you now that you will certainly perish. You will not have a long life on the land which you are crossing the Jordan to enter and occupy. I call heaven and earth today to witness before you. I have set before you life and death, the blessing and the curse. Choose life, then, that you and your descendants may live. By loving the Lord your God, heeding his voice, and holding fast to him. For that will mean life for you, a long life for you to live on the land which the Lord swore he would give to your fathers Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Back in January, I went, it's only the third time I've gone, but I went for the third time to the March for Life out in Washington, D.C., and one of the things that we took in as our group on one of the days where we had some free time was to actually go to the Holocaust Museum. I was very edified to see at the end of that, in the kind of prayer space that they have at the end of the museum, that it was this passage, or a section of this passage, that they had kind of emblazoned on the wall up there. But my point in starting with this is that in some sense, the moral choices that we make are either a choice for life or for death. Not maybe as starkly as that in a particular choice, but they are tending toward one of those two things. And so this stuff matters, in other words. The moral choices that we make have consequences that we have to look at very seriously. And we want to kind of build a life of virtue in which we are consistently choosing for the good, choosing life by those millions of little choices that we make throughout the course of a single day. Of course, sometimes we are faced with a more stark choice, and probably especially you as physicians and nurses and people working in the healthcare field, you know that choice, and you are faced with that. And of course, the Lord is inviting you, of course, to always to do what is best for your patient, for their life. So I think it's just good for us to kind of set this talk on fundamental moral theology within that perspective of every choice that we make being in some way either oriented toward life or toward death. What I'm going to share with you today, and I provided you an outline, is, and if you've looked over the outline already, you notice probably this is nothing earth-shattering, this is nothing particularly novel, this is nothing new. This may be very old hat for some of you who are very kind of up on your Catholic fundamental moral theology. Some of you will be maybe reminded of things that you had learned when you were younger. Some of you may not have heard some of this before. I was very much in that situation where in my own growing up, even though I grew up from a big Catholic family, we went to church on Sundays and pray before meals and all of those kind of things. There's a lot of this stuff that I didn't know until I went to seminary. I think part of that was I probably fell within that catechetical gap a little bit, where my parents, being of an older generation, presumed that I was getting in my religious education what they had got in their religious education, and I probably wasn't. And so they didn't know maybe to supplement that a little bit more in the home. So a lot of this stuff is very basic, but it is stuff that I learned again, really for the first time in seminary. As someone who has a license in moral theology, I have to admit I haven't used it a whole lot, except for in the very practical realities of parish life and ministry. So it's kind of the lab for moral theology, if you will. But I've recently started teaching at Assumption as well this last fall. Teaching the seniors moral theology in the first semester and vocations in the second semester. So it's given me an opportunity to kind of sharpen the blade a little bit because it gets dull after a while. It's been a number of years since I finished that degree, and opportunities like this certainly are helpful for me too, to kind of refresh myself in my knowledge of this stuff. So I want to start with just a very basic and very classic definition of morality. because even though it's very succinct, I think there's a lot of meaning packed in there. And that's that first or the second point on your outline. That this is the, oh, here we go. But I do hammer this home with my seniors as well, that morality, from our perspective, is the science of what humans ought to do by reason of who they are. And the first word that always strikes them, and probably strikes us too, is that word science. We don't think of morality as a science. We think of morality as something completely kind of subjective, or that is based more in the emotions, and so one person can have this morality and this person can have another morality, and they can in a sense both be right in some way. Of course we call this moral relativism, right? But this idea that morality is a science, in other words, it is something that can be studied, it is something that can be known, it's something that we can stand on, it's not just kind of a passing wind, it's something that is substantial, and it is worth our scrutiny, certainly. And of course that very fundamental word, ought, the science of what humans ought to do by reason of who they are, this is something that is called forth from us as human beings. And that last part, by who they are, in other words, this is rooted in our theological anthropology, an understanding of who it is that we are, made in the image and likeness of God. If we want to take, in a sense, the model of humanity, we would look to Jesus Christ. And that's sometimes jarring for us at first. We think, I don't compare at all to Jesus Christ. I'm way down here, and Jesus Christ is way up there. You know, let's lower the bar a little bit, Father, because then I might have a chance of maybe just skimming over it a little bit. But really, as Catholic Christians, our bar has to be, Jesus is, the Second Vatican Council talks about how Christ reveals man to man himself. He reveals our truest humanity to ourselves. So if there is a goal that we're looking toward in what it means to be fully human, we have to look at the person of Jesus Christ, who became fully human, though he was divine, without losing any of that divinity in the incarnation, right? So that's a high thing that is asked of us. But of course, God doesn't call us to something high like that without also giving us the grace in order to fulfill that vocation. So everything that is necessary for us to attain Christian perfection is offered to us. And then the rest is kind of worked out in the choices that we make. So it is the science, something that we can really know and study, of what we ought to do, what we're called to do, by reason of who we are, made in the image and likeness of God. There are then particular sources, if you will, that we draw from in our Catholic morality. The first would be, and this is again a shock to our students at the high school sometimes when I'm teaching them, that the first thing we draw from is human reason. Again, they think that morality is something totally subjective, or this is just kind of in the spiritual realm, and so you can you have a larger sandbox there. You can play with that kind of stuff. But the science is no, of course not. You know, and so when they hear that we're actually drawing from human reason, that we can look at the human person not only spiritually, psychologically, biologically, but we can look at the whole person and from reason begin to discern what they are made for and what is truly best for them. Probably no greater proponent of this, I think, in terms of the medical sciences, I think, in recent years than St. John Paul II in what's become known as the theology of the body, that we can look at the human body and see some sense written into that, you know, that we can draw from and act from. So human reason would be the first thing, and applying obviously philosophy and all of that as well to what is right and just. This isn't just for religious people in a sense. You know, we can read the pagan philosophers that lived 500 years before Jesus Christ and realize that using human reason, they were able to arrive at ethics, at a morality of how humans ought to act and interact with each other, right? Secondly, of course, human experience. We have a vast experience as human beings on this planet. A lot of that human experience is relayed for us right here in the scriptures. But even apart from divine revelation, we can look at our just what it means for us to be human over the whole course of human history and draw from that some sense of morality. And then thirdly, and what makes this, I think, a distinctively Christian or Catholic morality is divine revelation, that we're not left completely to our own devices or just with reason or just with experience to figure this stuff out, but God has communicated to us in a very direct way what he asks of us. And that's enshrined in things like the Ten Commandments and the Beatitudes and other laws and things like that that we draw from sacred scripture, right? Another point that I want to insert here is that morality, in addition to being the science of what we ought to do by reason of who we are, is really, we're not the origin, if you will, of morality. We're not the initiators of this. If you want to read good Lenten reading that would also square nicely with fundamental moral theology for this Lent, read 1 John, the first letter of St. John. But one of the parts of that letter in particular that I'm always drawn toward is that this idea that, you know, it was not, we didn't love God first. God loved us first. In that is love, that God loved us first. Everything else that we do then in the Christian life, in the moral life, is a response in some way to that love. Either to embrace that, to accept that, to live according to that, or to reject that in some way, right? So God makes this call to us first, and he's loved us first, and we simply respond to that. Again, I think there's an impression that moral theology is about all of these rules and all the things you can't do, all the lists of things that you cannot do. And really, that's kind of the opposite of what it was intended to be. Morality, all of the Ten Commandments, all of these things that are communicated to us through God and divine revelation, those things are given to us not to kind of impinge on us, not to kind of limit us or fence us in, but in fact to give us our truest freedom, right? And then morality is not just about making sure we're checking off all of those boxes and that we've got all of those things fulfilled, but God's calling us to even something even higher through those things. So I look at this in terms of kind of the difference between what we would call servile fear and filial fear, because you've often heard it throughout the scriptures, you know, the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord, and people hear that, the fear of the Lord, or when we talk to confirmation classes about that gift of the Holy Spirit, of fear of the Lord, they think, oh, you know, God's going to squish me like a bug if I do something wrong. That's the fear of the Lord, right, Father? No, this is a filial fear, the fear of a child offending a loving parent. You know, a child who knows that this person loves them so much and want to do the best for them, for fear of offending them in some way. Not a servile fear, which is indeed simply fear of punishment. So morality is this meant to be this response to God, to his love, not just a matter of following little rules or, keeping on our toes so as not to offend God and cause him to crush us or something like that. All of the moral life, all of the Christian life, really can be framed in that sense of vocation to beatitude. And by that I mean blessedness, like when we talk about the Beatitudes in Matthew 5 in the Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn. Blessedness or beatitude, especially eternal beatitude, that we're called to be blessed forever with God in heaven. Often that is, of course, translated as happiness. We had a professor in Rome who was teaching on the Beatitudes, hated any translation he would come across that said, happy are the poor in spirit, because he'd say, happiness is, a nice brandy and a good cigar or something like that. This is blessedness. I mean, how else could we say blessed are they who mourn? Blessed are they who are persecuted, It's not just, in other words, emotional kind of surface happiness, but a deep down soul satisfying, I am in right relationship with God, blessedness that we're ultimately called to in this life and in the next, of course. So that vocation to beatitude or blessedness or that vocation to holiness, the universal call to holiness that we talk so much about and really has been present throughout the history of the church, but was given in a sense in some new light in the Second Vatican Council, right? That universal call to holiness, that we're called to be saints, again, with Christ as kind of our benchmark, if you will. And then, with that idea of, before I go on to the before we go on to sin, I want to talk a little bit about. So some of you are probably of the generation that I could say, why did God make you? And you would respond, see if anybody gets it. Why did God make you?
To show forth his goodness and share in these everlasting happiness.
And when did you learn that, Father?
1953.
1953. And there are some different variations on that, but the other one you will hear, to know, to love, and to serve him in this life, and to be happy with him in the next, from the Baltimore Catechism. And I can, you know, if I'm visiting with the coffee clutch after Mass or something like that, I could just belt out that question, and they would stop everything that they were doing in unison, respond, to know, to love, and serve him, and to be happy with him forever in this life and in the next, you know. So they know that. I didn't learn that necessarily growing up. I'm sure my parents did. But that's really true. That really is the goal, right, of eternal beatitude, of eternal blessedness, to know, to love, and to serve God in this life, and to be happy with him forever in the next. I like St. Ignatius of Loyola's fleshing out of this a little bit more. At the beginning of his spiritual exercises, which is really intended to be this kind of 30-day intensive retreat, he starts with something called the first principle and foundation, which is basically, stating exactly what that old Baltimore Catechism phrase says. He says, man is created to praise, to reverence, and serve God our Lord, and by this means to save his soul, to know, to love, and to serve, and to be happy with him in this life and in the next, right? The other things on the face of the earth, St. Ignatius says, the other things are created for man to help him in attaining the end for which he is created. So everything else is there to help us toward that final end, eternal beatitude, our vocation to blessedness. Hence, man is to make use of them in as far as they help him in the attainment of his end, and he must rid himself of them in as far as they prove a hindrance to him. So of all of those things that are there to help me to eternal blessedness, I'm going to cling to those things that do indeed help me to that goal, but I'm going to distance myself from any of those things that do not help me in that goal, but in fact prove a hindrance to that. Therefore, he says, we must make ourselves indifferent to all created things. And we hear that word indifferent and we think apathetic. We think, oh, someone doesn't care about something. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about a kind of holy indifference where we're able to kind of step back from the situation and evaluate things almost from God's perspective, from a little bit more objective perspective. So he says we should be indifferent to all of those created things as far as we are allowed free choice and are not under any prohibition. And consequently, he says, as far as we are concerned, we should not prefer health to sickness, riches to poverty, honor to dishonor, a long life to a short life. The same holds for all other things. Instead, he says, our one desire and choice should be for that which is most conducive to the end for which I was created, namely, to praise, to reverence, and serve God our Lord, and by this means to save my soul. So a kind of holy indifference that can kind of, like I say, step back and say, I want, Lord, what is best for my eternal good. And if that means that in this life I have to endure some sickness, if that means in this life that I have to endure poverty, if I have to endure some disgrace or dishonor, if it means that I only live 24 years like St. Therese of Lisieux, I embrace that if that's what is best for my eternal salvation, for that vocation to beatitude to come to its final fruition, right? So I just love the way that he presents that and fleshes that out, but that vocation to beatitude is essential. Then all of the other choices that we make in life are in some way, like I say, either directing us toward that vocation to beatitude, or we're drawing away from that in some way, right? We're choosing life or we're choosing death very often in these little tiny ways throughout the course of life, right? The question then comes into, if we have this choice before, why did God even give us this choice to start with? I mean, wouldn't it just have been easier for God to say, I'm going to make you do the right thing all of the time because that is what is pleasing to me and that's what I want and you'll be happier for it too, I guarantee it. We'll just make it happen. God doesn't do that. And there are days when I think probably all of us wish he would. You know, God, you have the power. You can make me good. Why don't you just do it already? Make me good. And I think the reason I explained to the seniors that assumption is that God also knows that, you know, if the Christian life is a response to God's invitation of love, God knows in order for us to make that response authentically from ourselves, there has to exist this freedom to even say no to that. God makes himself, in a sense, vulnerable by that, you know, saying, I know that you could and likely will throw this back in my face, but I also know that in order to love me in return authentically, I have to give you this freedom. I have to give you this freedom. So that freedom becomes, you know, kind of the environment in which we can truly and freely choose God and to love him in return and thereby live a moral life. Just being forced, in a sense, to do the good thing all the time, you know, by God's kind of omnipotent hand would not necessarily make a moral life. The moral life is made up when you've got that freedom and you still choose to do what is right and good and just in the eyes of the Lord, right? So this is where sin then can enter in, is that, of course, we've got that choice, so and God knows that we might use that freedom to turn away from him. Or rather, I would say, use our free will. Sometimes those words get thrown interchangeably, you know, freedom and free will, and I do like to distinguish between them a little bit. I would consider free will that ability to choose either what is right or what is not right, and freedom would be that choosing for the good, right? The analogy I'll sometimes use is, you know, I've got the freedom or the free will, if I want, I should say, I've got the free will to try to put diesel fuel in my car, which runs on regular fuel, as it turns out, you know. I've got the free will to do that, assuming I could make it work and the nozzle would fit and all that kind of stuff. But it would not give me freedom. It would, in fact, inhibit my freedom, right? Because I wouldn't get very far down the road before my car broke down, right? So that's one way that I think we can kind of distinguish between freedom and free will. Free will, that ability to choose right or wrong. Freedom, the ability to choose what's good for us, ultimately, what is in keeping with our final vocation to beatitude, right? In terms of particular moral acts, so we talked kind of in general about the sources of our Catholic Christian morality being in human reason, human experience, and divine revelation. Those are the things that we draw from to build a Catholic morality. But in terms of particular moral acts, the Catechism in particular talks about three sources of a moral act. What makes an act either morally good or morally bad? Three things that we have to consider. And again, this is probably review for a lot of you. When I was coming right out of high school into college seminary, this was new to me at that time. But I think it's good for us to have this kind of these three things kind of committed to memory. This is one of the questions that at the end of the semester for the comprehensive final with the seniors at Assumption, I make sure that they know this, at least one of the things that I make sure that they know that they can walk away with. First would be what we call the moral object. And the best way to think of the moral object is this is the thing itself being done. This is the act itself, the what of the moral act. What are you actually doing? The thing itself being done. And this is really primary, the church would say, in determining the morality of the act itself. The first thing that we have to look at, in other words, is the act itself. And we would hold that there are some things that we would say are always and everywhere wrong. There are some moral acts that are in and of themselves, regardless of intentions and circumstances and that kind of thing, we know to be wrong. And that's written on our hearts in the natural law, and it's also revealed to us in divine revelation, right, through Scripture and the constant tradition of the Church. So the taking of an innocent human life, and there are many ways that that can happen, but the taking of an innocent human life would be one of those things. Certainly the church would say, this is always and everywhere wrong. There's not a way to kind of justify this or finagle this based on a person's good intentions or the particular circumstances and some of those things. Now, there are some tricky situations, and we can maybe get into that maybe more in our discussion, but just to say that object, the moral object, the act itself, is the primary thing that we have to look at in determining the morality of that act, whether it's morally good or morally evil. The next two things, then, are secondary, still very important, but secondary to the first, and that would be the intention, the reason, the why. If the object is the what, then the intention is the why am I doing this thing that I am doing, right? And this is, I think, where most of kind of 21st century morality is centered right now, is on intention. I meant to do something good. My heart was in the right place. I wanted to do this good, and that passes for morality for most of our culture. Is if there is a good intention somewhere in there, that's good enough. I will say that intention might mitigate against a person's personal culpability for an act, right? That they're not doing this maliciously. They're not doing this because they like to do evil things, right? They're trying to do some good. So when it comes to, for example, their final judgment, God may give them a little leeway in terms of their personal culpability, but it doesn't change the overall nature of the act itself. A good intention can't make a morally evil act good, right? The famous phrase, of course, the road to hell is paved with good intentions, right? That we make a lot of very bad choices sometimes, but with very good intentions. But those good intentions don't in themselves kind of transmute that act into something that it's not. And then thirdly, the circumstances. So this would be pretty much everything else. The what is the object, the why is the intention. This would be the who, where, when, how, all of that kind of stuff that might surround a particular moral act. Again, the circumstances are considered secondary, so they don't change the overall moral quality of the act itself, but they might increase or decrease the moral goodness of the act or the moral evil of the act. So for an example, many of you are doctors, nurses, in healthcare in some way. You know, you come upon an accident scene and there's a six-year-old child who's kind of running around not knowing what to do and frantic about what can they do to help this person that's in such pain on the floor and they don't know what to do and they don't do anything as a result. They're just kind of paralyzed by their fear. But you, all having some medical background at least, right? You're also standing there and you don't do anything. There's a huge difference, right, in the circumstances, right, of the morality of that act. It is not good not to act in some way, even maybe for the 6 or 7 year old child to say, can I help you or call 911 or do something, right? We would hope that they would act in some way at least. But that's less wrong, if you will, than someone who has some capability to help in this situation, not stepping in at all and kind of standing off on the sidelines, right? So there's an example of a who, one of the circumstances that can either increase or decrease the gravity of the act. Not changing the overall quality of the moral act itself, not turning it from bad to good or good to bad, but increasing its goodness or increasing its evil, in a sense, right? So those three things always have to be taken into consideration in evaluating any moral act. The object, the thing itself being done, why a person is doing that, and the circumstances. And those things should all be for the good in order for a moral act to be good, right? Again, I think in terms of personal culpability, circumstances certainly can mitigate against a person's responsibility for a particular act. You know, it was a crisis situation, I panicked, all of those kind of things. Again, in kind of the final judgment, God may be lenient in a sense because this person was in those circumstances. So from the subjective kind of understanding of morality, when we're talking about personal culpability, yes, intention and circumstances come into play. But when we're talking about the objective aspect of morality, in other words, whether a thing is good or not, intention and circumstances cannot change the overall morality of an act. On the next part of the outline there, on the second, I think it's on the reverse side of that page that I gave you, the question then comes into, well, where do kind of the emotions fit in here, or what in Catholic theology we typically call the passions. St. Thomas Aquinas called them the passions, but we know them to be the emotions. And again, this is another point where I think 21st century morality is really located on the emotions, right? It felt like the right thing to do. It felt like a good thing. I had a feeling that, or this was the nice thing to do, or this was there's a lot of kind of emotionalism that can kind of creep into the moral life. And I'm not saying the emotions are bad. In fact, I think they're good in a sense. The church would say they're in fact morally neutral. So they're neither good nor bad, they just kind of are, right? So for those of you, especially in psychological sciences and things like that, when you're meeting with a client or a patient, you can't, in a sense, judge the morality of their feelings. They feel how they feel. That's it, kind of morally neutral. Now, whether or not those emotions, those passions are acted on, in a positive direction, in a way that is moving in the direction of life, of what is good, what is right, what is just, then yeah, they certainly can be a great aid to that. But if they're going in the opposite direction, then they can be a great hindrance. But the emotions themselves, the passions, we would say, are morally neutral. And I think that's important for us to remind ourselves of, because, like I say, so many people today want to say that's where morality is, in the feelings, in the how I feel about something. Now, we'll get to conscience here next, and that's a little bit different than just a gut feeling. It's a little bit different than just kind of a sense of, you know, Jiminy Cricket on my shoulder telling me to do this. There's a little bit more to conscience than that. So conscience, then, probably the most, maybe the most misunderstood concept in moral theology today, and used as kind of the excuse for whatever I did according to my conscience. Never mind the fact that I never took the time to actually form my conscience about something, right? Not that I never did my homework. I never really applied myself to learning about this particular situation. If conscience is just this kind of acting blindly on a kind of gut instinct, then it is just like one of the emotions, one of the passions. It's not rooted in anything. It's very fickle. It can kind of come and go, if you will. So for us as Catholic Christians, conscience means something much more than that. The definition that the Catechism offers us is a judgment of reason. There's that word reason again, that reason can actually enter into our Catholic morality, into our decision making as Catholics, right? A judgment of reason whereby a human person recognizes the moral quality of a concrete act. In other words, looking through those three things, object, intention, circumstances. So we recognize the moral quality of a concrete act that he is going to perform, is in the process of performing, or has already completed or performed. But it's a judgment of reason. What is the right thing to do? I've looked at this, I studied this, I formed my conscience, I come into this with a lot of background, and then I make the best call that I can according to my conscience in the state that it is in. This is often called the subjective norm of morality. So if the objective norm of morality is kind of what we determine through that process of looking at object, intention, and circumstances, the subjective norm of morality is what I ought to do based on what my hopefully well-formed conscience tells me I ought to do, right? We get very well this idea that we should always follow our consciences. We understand that very well. And you see that in movies, you see that on television, you see that played out in a lot of different ways. But it's that second piece that is vitally important, the obligation to form one's conscience, that also has to be part of that package, right? And the Catechism even says that formation of conscience is a lifelong task. It's not as though you go to school for moral theology and you've got a perfectly formed conscience. It's not as though you reach adulthood and you've got a perfectly formed conscience. We're constantly having to kind of hone our consciences and continue to form and inform them. When we get to the section on conscience with my students at Assumption, I always like to show a few little snippets of A Man for All Seasons, which of course is based on the Robert Bolt play of the same name about the life of St. Thomas More, because it deals a lot with conscience and his personal conscience and why he couldn't sign this thing that said that King Henry was the supreme head of the church in England. And he, God knows, looked for ways that he could sign that. In fact, in one of those scenes, this decree has come out and he runs to his daughter Meg is like, what does it say? What are the words? What are the words in this thing? Is there a way that I can possibly sign this thing? Because, you know, words have meaning, and there may be a way to construe this, that I could actually sign this in good conscience without violating my conscience, and we'd be free and clear, and I wouldn't have to worry about what repercussions may come. So he looked for a way to do this, and of course he examines it and realizes, no, there's no way in good conscience, his well-formed conscience, that I could sign this thing. Of course, he never divulges his conscience really until sentence has already been passed on him. Another great scene in that movie, in that play about conscience, is when one of his buddies, the Duke of Norfolk, and the House of Norfolk actually remained Catholic, I think, till this day. The only people in the English royal family that remained Catholic, and for that reason they're automatically discounted from ever having a throne. But the Duke of Norfolk, I think, probably, and his family were very impressed by Thomas's Thomas's approach to this whole situation and his fidelity to his own conscience, that they said there must be some reason why he stood his ground there, and they remained Catholic. But in one of the scenes, his buddy, the Duke of Norfolk, who's his good friend, is saying, you know, I'm not a scholar of the law. Why don't you just sign it? Look at the names on this thing. Look at the people who have signed this. Why can't you just do like they did and sign it and be done with it? And he says, why don't you sign it for fellowship's sake? And Thomas says back to him, and when you go to heaven for doing according to your conscience, and I go to hell for not doing according to my conscience, will you follow me for fellowship's sake? Pretty bold. But what's nice about that statement, too, is he recognizes, look, I have no window into your heart or into your soul. I don't know the state of your own conscience. I only know my own conscience, and my conscience won't allow me to do this, won't allow me to sign this thing. So he's not damning or condemning anybody. He's saying, you, if you're doing according to your conscience as best you know how, as best as it has been formed, then you know, by all means, God can receive you into the heavenly kingdom. But I know myself, and I know I can't sign this thing. So it's a judgment of reason whereby a person knows, recognizes that moral quality of an act. And I think it's telling that it describes it as knowing or recognizing the moral quality of an act that they're going to perform, either in the future, or something that is being done in right now in the present, or something that has been done in the past. In other words, conscience works at all three of those stages. It works prior to something. It helps us to determine whether or not we ought to do something, right? It can help us in the midst of something where we realize suddenly, this is not right. I should not be doing this. I need to stop, right? And it can even help us afterwards to realize, I should not have done that. You know, to make an examination of our conscience, right? And then in order to go, you know, to be reconciled to God and to his church, especially what a great gift we have in the Catholic Church of the sacrament of reconciliation, where even when our conscience is pricked because of something we've done in the past, we don't have to sit with that forever and just kind of be shamed by that, but we can bring it to the Lord in the sacrament and be healed to God. We can bring it to the divine physician, if you will. Another key Catholic principle, and by the way, a lot of this is just the outline. Read the section in the Catechism on this, and this follows kind of the outline that the Catechism lays out for us. And I should mention, too, in talking about the Catechism, kind of the brilliance in the way that it's laid out for us. You know that it's in four parts. The first part of the Catechism is all about what we believe. And the second part of the Catechism is how we celebrate or how we kind of pray what we believe. And then the third part is life in Christ, so how we live what we believe. And then the fourth part is on prayer more specifically. But those first three parts in that specific order, I think, are important. And I try to emphasize this with the students at Assumption, too, is that, you know, being Catholic is not just about kind of intellectually assenting to a set of things that we believe, you know, the Trinity, the Incarnation, you know, the dogmas of Mary, these different things. It's not just about this kind of head process where, yeah, check, I believe that, that's okay with me. That has to be lived, and it has to be celebrated in the sacraments and all. So it's a total package, you know. The Latin phrase that was often used was lex orandi, lex credendi, which meant, you know, the law of prayer is the law of believing. So we pray what we believe, and we believe what we pray. So all of the prayers, and you especially see this like in the collects, those opening prayers for Mass, they reflect just beautifully what we actually believe. They reflect those creedal statements, right? And what we believe, the creed, finds its expression in the liturgy and in all of those beautiful prayers and in the way that we celebrate our faith and in the sacraments, right? So lex orandi, lex credendi, but then that would be the lex vivendi, the law of living. So not only do we believe what we pray and pray what we believe, but we live what we pray and believe, or at least that's the goal, right? That these things are integrated, not to be kind of lived separately, right? But one of the other key principles that the Catechism lays out is that you can never do directly evil so that good may result from it, right? You can never do something that is objectively, where that moral object is already in and of itself wrong. You can never do something that is evil in order that good may result of it. This is a little bit different than what comes to be called the principle of double effect, where we could say a single action has two effects, opposite effects, a good effect and a bad effect. And the church would say you can tolerate the bad effect, so you're not willing the bad effect, you're not actively pursuing the bad effect, you're not doing the bad effect, you're not doing evil, the good may result of it, you're merely tolerating the evil effect that comes from this same one act for the sake of the good, for the sake of the good, right? Maybe a good, a simple, you know, example of that would be, you know, having to amputate a limb or something like that. Normally, under normal circumstances, that's not a good thing, right? That's bad. Your body's meant to be this integral whole, and your limbs and all of these kind of things. But if it means saving the life of the person, if it means actually giving them life by having to amputate a limb, then that bad effect of having to not have that limb or to have to get a prosthetic or to have to learn to live without that limb, that bad effect can be tolerated for the sake of the good, which is the overall life and health of a person, right? Now, this is where I think Catholics get accused of kind of hair-splitting a little bit, but there is a big difference to me in directly doing or willing an evil that a good may result of it, and doing something that is at least morally neutral, if not morally good, that has these two divergent effects, good and bad, and tolerating the bad for the sake of the evil, as long as, tolerating the bad for the sake of the good, as long as the good is proportionate, right? That's the other thing that comes into the principle of double effect, is that, you know, someone might undergo, you know, well, people do. I mean, they undergo elective surgeries that are absolutely non-essential for their health, maybe for the sake of vanity or beauty or pride or whatever. You know, they'll undergo things that are potentially even life-endangering, right? We would say in those cases the good is not proportionate to the evil to be endured in that case. In that case, then the principle of double effect doesn't come into play. It's not that you can endure this great evil that might mean even your death so that you can have this good that is relatively minor in the larger scope of things, right? But you can, the idea that you can never do evil that good may result, but with the principle of double effect, there is a way that we can talk about tolerating, like I say, a bad effect for the sake of the good, as long as the act itself is morally neutral and the good itself has to be proportionate. There's good movement, I think, now, not just starting now, it's been going on for probably 20, 30 years, in Catholic moral theology, of kind of a return to talking about the virtues in regard to Catholic moral theology. So that, again, this is not just about a bunch of stuff that we can't do, but in fact about living a life that is fully alive for the sake of God, that is in accord with our final beatitude, with our eternal happiness, right? And the virtues come into play in that. The basic definition of virtue is simply a habitual or firm disposition to the good. So this is not just the one time I did something nice for somebody, aren't I a virtuous person? No, we have to make a habit of those kind of things in order to claim virtue, right? It has to become something that becomes a part of us, not just something that we do every once in a great while. But something that is just out of almost nature, it just flows from us after a while. So we make a habit, we have a firm disposition toward doing the good. And of course we talk about the cardinal virtues, prudence, justice, fortitude, temperance, and the theological virtues, faith, hope, and charity. But all of these things, all of these virtues are a way that we can look at approaching the moral life that is much more about doing something positive than it is about avoiding negative things, cultivating a life of virtue, cultivating a life of habit of doing the good. I want to talk a little bit more about sin, kind of as the opposite. The Catechism treats virtue and sin kind of next to each other for good reason, because they're kind of on opposite ends of each other. But the definition of sin, again, this word reason comes up, which I find very interesting, and the students usually do, assumption do, but that sin is actually an offense against reason. It's an offense against reason. It's not reasonable. It's not rational. It's not logical. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense. It flies in the face of all that makes sense. So it's an offense against reason, against truth, against right conscience. And then I love this line, and it draws back again to the first letter of John in that response our loving response to God who has first loved us. It is a failure in genuine love for God and neighbor caused by a perverse attachment to certain goods. A failure to love is ultimately what sin is, right? There's an opportunity at every little corner to love our neighbor, to love God through our neighbor, to love our neighbor because we love God, and if we refuse that, then that's what we call sin. Going back to that idea too of final beatitude or happiness or blessedness, better the Greek word in for sin that is all throughout the New Testament is hamartia. Hamartia. I don't have to write that out if you don't want to, but it literally means missing the mark. Missing the mark. In other words, everything that we do, even the sinful things that we do, are in some way still aiming at that goal of happiness, of blessedness. Only our aim is off when we sin. Something distracts us and the arrow flies off this way or that way. Or we think we're aiming at the right target, but we're aiming in the opposite direction. So except for maybe a few exceptional people in history that want to do what is evil and knowing full well that it's evil and are completely acting out of malice, I want to believe, at least there's not that many people that are doing that. Most everybody on the planet over the whole course of human history has been aiming for what they think is happiness, blessedness, what is right, what is just. And if they have done terrible things, their aim is off. Hamartia, sin, is literally missing the mark. But this offense against reason, truth, right conscience, the failure to love God and our neighbor in a genuine way, usually because of some attachment, right, to a certain good, whether it's honor or things, whatever it may be. The church does distinguish, as you're well aware, I'm sure, between mortal and venial sins, and a lot of people want to say, oh, a distinction between mortal and venial sin was probably a creation of the medieval church at some point, just to kind of, because they like to be particular on these kind of, no, this is right out of scripture again, from the first letter of John. You know, he talks about there are some sins that are not mortal, that are not deadly in a sense. In other words, they don't cut off the life of grace in a sense. They don't turn away from God. They may damage the relationship with God in some way. The venial sins would be those that don't turn away from God, that damage the relationship, but mortal sins would be those that do in some way cut off that relationship, that turn away from God. And you can find that in 1 John chapter 5 and verses 16 through 17, that distinction right from the beginning in sacred scripture of the difference between mortal or deadly and venial or less serious sin. It's not to say that venial sin is okay. In fact, the church still encourages confession of venial sins. The church doesn't say you have to confess your venial sins, but the church says it's a good thing in the same way that I might not need to, clean my house more than a couple times a year, good thorough cleaning, but guess what? It stays a lot cleaner if I take care of some of the little stuff along the way, right? So that I don't have this gigantic mess to have to deal with at a future date. So a good way to maybe look at that distinction between mortal and venial sin as well. There are three conditions that the church would say have to be present for a sin to be considered mortal or deadly. And again, we're talking more here subjectively in terms of the person. I don't have a window into another person's conscience, but I know my own conscience, and so I can kind of determine these things in my own conscience, which I hope is reasonably well-formed, in order to know whether or not I have committed a mortal sin. The first is that there has to be some sort of grave matter. And by grave matter, the church usually uses the criteria of the Ten Commandments. Is this in some way a violation of one of the Ten Commandments? Not necessarily a direct violation, Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount says, you have heard it said, you shall not kill, but I say if you harbor anger or hatred toward your brother, you've already, in a sense, violated that commandment. There can be anger, there can be hatred that is certainly a mortal sin. It's not the same as physically killing your brother or your sister, but that doesn't mean that it's not mortal or deadly, right? So, but it has to be, in other words, in some way a violation of the Ten Commandments. That's probably the best kind of rule of thumb for determining whether or not this constitutes grave matter. Where there is question on this, the Catechism often will clarify that and says, the Church considers this to be, and we use that word, a grave offense, or it considers this to be a grave matter. Sometimes when we're not sure whether something is grave or not, the church will clarify that for us. But there has to be grave matter. Secondly, there has to be full knowledge. Obviously, again, on that subjective level, the person can't be culpable for something that they honestly did not know was wrong. And this does happen. Father Tony can probably attest to that too, where you have, you know, somebody in the confessional and they had never confessed the sin, because no one had ever said anything about it, and now they read something or they saw something on TV, or they read a book or they heard a sermon, and they realized, oh my goodness, I got to bring that to the sacrament, you know. Very innocent, truly, in the way that they may have been going about something. Sometimes it's feigned lack of knowledge, but sometimes it is really lack of knowledge of something, right? So grave matter, full knowledge, so it has to be bad, and I have to know that it's bad, right? And then thirdly, I have to willingly give myself to that which I know is bad, right? So that's where the deliberate consent comes into play. So it's bad, I know it's bad, I'm going to do it anyhow. That's the bottom line. That's the way to kind of remember those three criteria, I think. Deliberate consent, though, can even get a little bit muddy because force of habit, addiction, and things like that, when we talk about that, that can really mitigate a person's consent. At a certain point, especially in cases of addiction, they're not completely in control of their faculties, if you will. Their will is in some ways not their own, at least not completely. They're acting from that addiction, from that sense of I have to have this, or I need this for this reason, right? So there can be things that would mitigate against someone's deliberate consent. If one of those three things is missing, the church would say it's not a mortal sin. Objectively, we may say it's grave matter. We may say this is serious stuff. But in terms of evaluating the culpability of the person themselves, if we find that yes, indeed it was grave matter, but the person had no idea that this was a sin, or the person was not acting consensually in this particular act, then at a subjective level, and you know, in terms of again evaluating their personal culpability, we would say that is not a mortal sin. Should they confess it? Certainly should. Yeah. Should they be on guard that they don't commit this in the future? Absolutely, they should. And you know, with some of these things, especially when it comes to deliberate knowledge, you know, ignorance is bliss, right? I can kind of continue to do what I want as long as I don't know what is right or wrong, and I will even take opportunities to plug my ears sometimes to keep from hearing what I know is right or wrong, so that I don't willfully give this. So I'm constantly apologizing to my seniors for robbing them of their ignorance on some of these points, you know, that, well, sorry, now you know. So category one is fulfilled, category two is fulfilled, category three, deliberate consent, that's up to you all, you know. But you know this is wrong, and there, now it's in your court, if you will. I want to end on a kind of a more positive note. Other good Lenten reading that I would encourage you to look at, especially in these days, if you are feeling like I know what is good and I don't always do what I good, and there's just this fight within me all the time, and I'm just constantly kind of fighting with myself, then read Romans chapter 7. Read Romans chapter 7, because you will find in St. Paul an ally who has been in that fight with you. That whole chapter is just this kind of lament of, I know what is good, but I don't do the good that I want to do. I do the thing that I hate. I do the very thing that I hate. There is this war going on within my members, he says, right? And so you kind of get through that chapter 7 and you're like, I know exactly what he's talking about. And I think it's good for us as Catholic Christians 2,000 years later to see that, you know, our forefathers and mothers had the same struggles, right? That they were in the same soup as we are with the moral life, right? Breaking into chapter 8, the next words out of St. Paul's mouth after he's kind of lamented this war that is going on within his members, he says this: Hence, now there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has freed you from the law of sin and death. For what the law, weakened by the flesh, was powerless to do, this God has done by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for the sake sin in the flesh, so that the righteous decree of the law might be fulfilled in us who live not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. So Paul reaches this point where he recognizes, yeah, I'm by myself. I will lose this battle within myself. But thanks be to God for Jesus Christ, who was sent to free us from that law of sin and death and to open up for us this law of life in the Spirit. Hopefully moral theology in the way that it's lived is really about life in the Spirit. And that's something we've seen, I think, an increase of in the last several decades, too, in the field of moral theology, is bringing back together spiritual theology and moral theology, that moral theology isn't just this little thing over here that is divorced from our relationship with God or divorced from the movements of the Holy Spirit, the gifts and the fruits of the Holy Spirit, but smack in the middle of all of those things, right? It's about life in the Spirit. That is about the time that I was told this talk, so I'll